unaware and perfectly self-enlightened, worshipless Buddha, consummated in knowledge and behavior.
Hello to you, friends. This is indeed Dhamma on Air, number 110. Dhamma on Air, number 110. A noble speech, and what to say, and when to say it.
Friends, what is the seven fruits, the seven results of the seven links to awakening? The Blessed Buddha once said, because the exquisitely refined and sophisticated seven links to awakening do never arise apart from the appearance of a welcome one, an arahant, a perfectly self-enlightened Buddha. They never emerge outside the discipline of a thus happy and successful one. Which seven? The awareness linked to awakening, sati sampayanga. The investigation linked to awakening, dhamma vichaya sampayanga. The energy linked to awakening, virya sampayanga. The joy linked to awakening, piti sampayanga. The tranquility linked to awakening, prasati sampayanga. The concentration linked to awakening, samadhi sampayanga. And the equanimity linked to awakening, upekkha sampayanga. Because when these seven links to awakening have been developed, completed, and refined, the winning of these seven fruits is indeed to be expected. What are the benefits of these seven fruits? They are either 1. One attains final knowledge early in this life, or 2. One attains final knowledge the moment of death, or having destroyed the five lower chains and spontaneously realizing as a deva, one attains nibbana in the first half life of this divine Brahma life. Or 4, one attains nibbana in the second half of the life in these pure abodes. Or 5, one attains nibbana as a noble non-returner without effort. Or 6, one attains nibbana as a noble non-returner with some effort. Or 7, one is bound upstream, surely heading towards the highest Akanita realm. When, because these seven links to awakening have been thoroughly developed and cultivated exactly in this very way, these seven fruits and benefits may be expected. The seven links to awakening are unmatched. Venerable Sariputta once told the Buddha, unsurpassable is how the Blessed Buddha has taught the supreme efforts embedded within these seven links to awakening. That is, the awareness linked to awakening, the investigation linked to awakening, the energy linked to awakening, the joy linked to awakening, the tranquility linked to awakening, the concentration linked to awakening, the equanimity linked to awakening. Venerable Sir, among all these supreme Dhamma teachings and supreme mental states, this doctrine on the seven links to awakening is also utterly unsurpassable. How are there 14 links to awakening? The Blessed Buddha once said, there's awareness of all internal states and awareness of all external states. Both kinds of awareness are leading to enlightenment. There's investigation of both all internal states and all external states. Both these investigations are links to enlightenment. There's energy of the body, endurance, and energy of the mind, enthusiasm. Both kinds of energy are leading to enlightenment. There's joy associated with thinking, and there's joy without any thinking. Both kinds of joy are leading to enlightenment. There's tranquility of the body, and there's tranquility of the mind. Both these calms are linked to enlightenment. Both these calms are links to enlightenment. There's concentration doing thinking, and there's concentration without any thinking. Both kinds of concentration are links to enlightenment. There's equanimity, both regarding any internal state and any external state. Both these kinds of equanimity are links to enlightenment. This can only a Buddha or a true disciple of a Buddha see and explain. Some comments: awareness of all internal mental states is the most important and the highest. Investigation of all internal mental states is the primary and most fruitful. Energy of the mind is the most advantageous, effective, and most enabling. Joy without any thinking is the most rapturous, ecstatic, and all-pervading. Tranquility of the mind is the deepest, serene, and imperturbable calm. Concentration without thinking is the most one-pointed and absorbed. Equanimity regarding internal mental states is the best guard and protection. And the source text for these edited extracts are the grouped or connected sayings of the Buddha, the Samyutta Nikaya, Book 46, on the links to awakening, and it's Sutta number 52, a way of explaining. And then there was also something from the Digha Nikaya, the exhaustive speeches of the Buddha, Digha Nikaya number 28. Sampasadhanaya Sutta, confirmed conviction. Thank you.
Hello to you, friends. This is Dhamma on Air, number 110. There are three questions. Remember to click subscribe there, the bell there, and like if you like. But first, the normal intro. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha, indeed. The first question goes like this, is question 339. How to control speech so not to say the wrong thing at the wrong time? Yeah, the first general rule one can say, which works in all cases, is reflect upon your speech. That is, think about what you're going to say before you say it, while you're saying it, and after you said it. This is a good way. Usually when one are unable to reflect on it because of hurry, being in a hurry, or being agitated, or being angry, especially, or being unkind, or being unhinged, or maybe even being intoxicated, then it's because of not reflecting before it comes out the mouth. So this means the speech could have, if it was considered upon and reflected upon a little longer, then it would be more eloquent, more fluent, more kind, and also in many cases more true. So there's this fourfold reflection. It goes like this. First of all, is it, what I'm going to say, is it true? If it's not true, then never say anything that is not true, false, or pretending something, or bending the truth in some way. Secondly, is it advantageous? Is it advantageous for me? Is it advantageous for those who hear it, and those who come to hear and hear it later on, if it's recorded or written down? It is advantageous for me, it's advantageous for them, now, later, and much later. This is good, because then you can say, whatever is true, maybe not advantageous to say. So it has to be both true and advantageous. Then one can say it. The third aspect is to reflect upon, is it kind? Is it spoken of with from a good heart? What effect, for example, when giving critique, righteous critique that is both true and beneficial, advantageous for the one who hears it, what then to speak, this is not kind, then one should wait until the right moment. So the two first rules, that is true and advantageous, cannot be dispensed. But it need not be kind necessarily in all cases. However, if it's not kind, one knows this is not kind, they don't, he or she or they will not like it because it's a tough speech, then one should wait until the right moment. And one can also add, one should speak to the right persons then, who can take it. The fourth aspect is it acceptable? Is it something, if one reflect upon the specific persons that's gonna hear it, can they accept it or not? And there Buddha, he would never say something that would provoke the listener to fall into disbelief, that he has seen something that they could not believe. And has in the modern context, one should not speak about devas or mystical phenomena or rare events like elevation or so on to the Western materialist, because then he will evaluate the speaker to be superstitious or babbling. So then there's no need to say. Then one can say something else that is both true, advantageous, and kind, but not something that this person cannot accept. So this is the fourth reflection. Is it true? Yes, say it. No, never speak it. Is it advantageous? If yes, can't be said. If no, no speech. Is it kind? Not kind, wait for the right time. Is it acceptable to the listener? If it's not acceptable, not understandable right away, then one should wait until the right time to speak it. So I think 98%, 99% of wrong speech, which we'll come to the definition of later, comes about as a reality because of not reflecting over these four rules. True, advantageous, kind, acceptable. So if one do that, then one will automatically improve one's speech. Not only will it become more efficient as a communication tool, it will also become more kind and more beautiful and fluent and eloquent. The Buddha said, monks, a statement endowed with five factors is well spoken, not ill spoken. It is blameless and unfolded by the knowledge people. Which five? It is spoken at the right time. It is spoken in truth. It is spoken affectionately, kind. It is spoken beneficially, advantageous. It is spoken with a mind of goodwill. Again, this kindness, this gentleness. Anguttara Nikaya 598, Book of Fives. So if we go back to right speech, which is a factor of the Noble Eightfold Way, it's said like this. There's this fourfold definition of right speech.
One, avoiding all lying, all false speech, but also all pretending and all bending of the truth. Two, abstaining from any divisive splitting talk. That is, you heard something there, then you go to tell to those over there with the purpose, intentional purpose of splitting, of dividing these two parties. And what you heard over there from him or her, this you go and tell this or that person. With the purpose specifically of splitting these two. So if you heard something private there or disadvantageous or something that should be regarded as discreet, then you babble up over there with it. This should not be done. Once you just think about it, never slander other beings. Never. The saying within Buddhist practice is that one should protect the other secrets. These secrets one comes to know because they have confidence in one. This one should protect. Then people will have confidence and faith in one over a prolonged period. Because they never backstab, so to speak, by speech. However, while protecting others' secrets, then one should expose clearly one's own secrets. So this is the rule. Protect other secrets, expose your own. Good rule for Buddhist practice. About the first lying. The danger in lying for the person who transgressed this one thing, I tell you, there's no evil deed that this person cannot do. Which one thing is that? That is lying. This one should know, if a person is lying, then they can also kill. Even you, they can kill themselves and can kill other people. This is possible. So, today, psychologists say we lie 5 times on average per day. If they video people with hidden cameras and then count up how many statements they made that was not true by checking them, then it's 5 times a day. This is far too much. And this is a kind of like a signature for our time, that there has been a slowly moral decay. And now this rule of lying, which you find in all ethics and in all religions, not to lie, not to speak false. Well, this rule has to some extent become degraded. And thereby also people tend to think, because there's a social convention on you can't tell gray lies and so forth. It doesn't matter so much and so on. It has been socially accepted to some extent, this habit of lying. And this is not good. The Buddha said, the person who lies, who transgresses this one thing, transcending concern for the world, doesn't matter what the world here, there's no evil he might not do. Ittivutaka 25. So there's no evil. As soon as there's this lie, then there's no evil. They can rob, kill, steal. That's possible. Speak only words that do no harm. One should speak only word by which not torment others, nor torment oneself. That word is indeed well spoken. So never let harmful speech out the mouth. It's easy to recognize. All forms of anger, easy to recognize, both for the others and for oneself. If there's anger in there or splitting talk, divisive talk, then one should not speak it. So one should, it's a rule number 3, refrain from all aggressive and irritated scolding. No aggressive speech. Then one should stilling of any idle and empty gossiping. This 4 rules are right speech, defines right speech. Not to lie, not to split or divide, not to scold anybody with aggressive or angry speech, and no idle speech or gossiping about, no empty speech, you can say, about things that doesn't have any meaning or no importance. One should speak only pleasant words, words which are acceptable to others. What one speaks without bringing evil to others is pleasant. Dhamma 21. So pleasant speech that is worth remembering for others, that is also true and advantageous. This is, of course, speech that is worth remembering and can transmit a real meaning. Speak only speech that neither torments self nor does harm to others. That speech is truly well spoken. Speak only endearing speech, speech that is welcomed, speech which brings no evil to others. Why is it that this evil to others is so important? Yes, because it will bounce back karmically as evil towards oneself. So the Buddha knows that man is born with an axe in his mouth, whereby he cuts himself down, whereby he cuts his own future down by this wrong speech of lying, dividing, gossiping, scolding, and empty, idle babble. So this one should not speak. There's 10 advantageous subjects about which one can speak with safety and with confidence. That is to talk on modesty of having few wants, talk on the bliss of contentment, talk on the joy of seclusion, talk on the ease of disentanglement, talk on the energy of enthusiasm, talk on the advantage of morality, talk on the calm of concentration, meditative concentration, talk of the insight of understanding, penetrative insight, talk on the freedom of release, and talk on the direct knowledge and vision of release. That is right speech. And as opposition to it, then we can define the many kinds of pointless talk, also today called news. Such talk as on kings, robbers, ministers, armies, dangers, war, foods, drinks, clothing, furniture, jewelry, cosmetics, relatives, vehicles, villages, towns, cities, countries, women, heroes, places, amusements, the dead, trifles, the origin of the world, the origin of the sea, whether metaphysical things are so or not so. Such talk is pointless, irrelevant, detrimental, empty of any advantage. So most of 99.9% of what streams out the conventional media, that is newspapers, TV, and also YouTube and Facebook and so on, this is basically pointless talk. They're not connected with the goal of Nirvana. They're not connected with any advantage either. It's just kind of like pointless talk, pointless speech. Regarding the difficult one, I think everybody can admit that on truth, speaking the truth absolutely always. Then I made a special video called Truth Always Triumph, and I give the link here below and below in the video also, which is recommendable, because this goes into depth about this, how one comes about to lie, usually because of one wants to protect another one, or one wants to protect oneself from bad things happening. Maybe one wants to hide over a mistake or a bad habit for oneself, such as abuse of any kind, or a mistake at the job, and then one is tempted to speak a lie. But this is very expensive, karmically speaking, so this one should cut out. And it's something that one has to train for a prolonged period, where one becomes more and more aware and more sharp-sighted about what is on the gray side of the lie, which basically is false, and what is right on the line and basically true. So this becomes more and more fine, more and more sharp, sharply defined. And that is good, because then the lie, the false speaking, the pretending, it goes down, 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 until almost zero. And then it is, becomes a behavioral habit to stick to the truth, even when one recognizes that there might be consequences of it, which is unlikable. Then usually people on the other side of the communication, they react positively to one's big surprise, because when they can see one, it took an effort to speak the truth. Question 304 is not that happiness of two types. One being worldly happiness based on transient condition, thus not lasting, and the second type not based on mundane conditions and thus stable and safe. Yes, it is exactly so. One can say from an overall perspective, what is the meaning of life? What is it that consciousness wants? It wants to dwell in the state of happiness, lasting happiness. So there's these two kinds of happiness. There's transient happiness, it comes and goes, and then there's lasting happiness. And lasting happiness cannot be found in samsara, because inside samsara is no lasting things. This means that there are no place, no nail you can hang your hat on and trust. And the Buddha say, if there was just one thing here in this world that was lasting, stable and safe, trustable in the absolute sense, then the living the noble life was not necessary, and it could not be done, actually. Because then one could hang one's happiness on this one single stable object. If it was dependent upon this such an object, then the happiness would also be stable. But anything in this world, in this samsara, in this mundane conditions, this is unstable, it's not safe, because of impermanence. Because it's via Dhamma, it is Dhamma that comes and goes, that are bound inherently, immanently, by nature, by its own nature and essence, to have these three phases of arising, presence, and ceasing again. Because it's catch 22, if you fall in love with the object when it arises, then when it ceases, you lose it, you come out of contact with it, you being disassociated from it, whether it's the health, the partner, the economy, the job, the social position, the reputation, whatever, inside samsara here, in this world. Well, then this is this impermanence, transience. And therefore, because you become addicted to it habitually by experiencing it once, twice, and so on, then there's more pain, because the pain starts already here when it starts to go down. It's agreeable when the phenomena comes and rise, but then when it starts to cease, then even though it's up here, it becomes disagreeable. It turns into suffering. Some Zen Buddhists go as far as saying, Chinese Zen Buddhists, I show the clip here below, as saying that this joy, this gladness, this happiness that we experience in this world is also suffering. It is not different from suffering, because it has these three phases. It's only agreeable in the start, but in the end, then it turns into suffering, disappointment, because one is addicted to that it is on a high level. Then one cannot go back to a lower level of joy and happiness. And the Zen Buddhist explanation of it comes right here.
忘掉心灭的时候，它是你这个，你智慧就自然流上起来的，也不分别的想苦啊，也不分别的想快乐。实际上这些快乐和苦，都是一样的。
So, since it is so, undeniably so, that all inside samsara here, on the 31 levels of existence, whether humans of level 5 or even of the highest level, they dwell in some happiness that is dependent upon the world and thereby impermanent. This means that the only way to go to find lasting happiness is actually to approach Nibbana and to enter Nibbana. Because only there, which is outside space-time, there is no impermanence. There's no not lasting phenomena. So, since it is so that there is no not lasting phenomena, then one can trust whatever is experienced in there, because it's lasting. Question 341. How to gladden the mind during meditation without falling into the trappings of pleasurable sensations and gratitude for safety and well-being? In short, all that is impermanent. Yes, there's two ways. One easy way and one little more difficult way. The easy way I use myself, it is to think about something. If you want to gladden the mind, then you think about something that traditionally makes you glad. And I usually say, yabba-dabba-doo. Then I think about some Disney scenes from old comics stripes I've seen. And this automatically elevates the mind. When the mind is elevated by gladness and joy, then it has a chance to reach happiness. And it's important because happiness opens the door to satisfaction and then peace. And then right after peace, entry into the first jhana. So happiness and pleasure has to be there in the continuum of mind. So on what should we meditate to gladden the mind? Yeah, there's calm and then absorption, then any favorite object. So this is any favorite object, whatever makes you glad, whatever makes you jubilant, think about that habitually. Can be a nice person or scene or from a film or for something that you experienced or childhood memory or whatever that makes you happy. Even foolish things. The happiness and the gladness is the purpose. The object is not so important. The other one is one can experience some level of calm during initial stages of meditation. Then one remembers or redirects the mind to this level of calm. If one can experience jhana, then one redirects the mind to this experience of jhana last time one experienced it. Then this will gladden the mind. Then one gets access to a new round of jhana. So that's basically the trick. Find a favorite object that makes you happy and then repeat like yuppie, jabba dabba doo, exultingly jubilant. One should make one. And then this will elevate the mind. There is a factor of this joy, piti, that we say, what is the feeding factor of joy? This is joy itself. So there's a positive feedback loop with joy. Getting to the state of joy makes more joy, so it feeds itself, a positive feedback loop. So man can start with a little joy, and then one can easily make it bigger and bigger and bigger. Why should we try to make the mind glad when we should actually set it free? Why is this joy, this gladdening needed in the first place? Yes, as I just said, access to jhana and also access to kanika samadhi, momentary concentration, requires that the mind is satisfied, it's glad, it's in joy, it's basically happy. If you have pain in the knee and it's very unhappy of that, or very unhappy about the last bills that dumped in the door yesterday, then it's difficult to reach jhana. It's difficult to reach absorption, and it's difficult to reach even calm samadha. So basically, it's a state of mind that mind wants. It wants to be happy. It wants to stay in joy or in gladness. And then this means also that mind is continually looking for it, scanning for it. And if it's not in it, any joy, or in joy, in gladness, or in happiness, so to speak, inside that state of mind, yeah, then it keeps scanning. Where can I find it? Where can I find a stimuli, either a mental stimuli or a physical stimuli from outside, that can make me happy? And while it's scanning, it's, there's some certain degree of agitation, of unrest, because it's searching for something. So one has to feed the mind what it's searching for, this gladness. As soon as this, the mind enters this door of this state of mind called gladness, then it calms down and stops scanning. It stops scanning. Why does it stop scanning? Because it already has what it wants. It's already inside what it looks for. And therefore, it don't need to scan. And this then opens the door for one-pointedness, where mind stays on the very same object for prolonged periods of time. And this is this will then gain access concentration or neighborhood concentration, upachara samadhi. This will make this arise, this emerge, this state of mind. And then one is close to jhana, where one burns through. So this is why one should gladden the mind. Thanks for your advantageous attention, your clever consideration, and your kind contribution. Thanks to all the Dayakas, all the supporters, and all the donors. And may you indeed have a nice and noble day. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha indeed. Thank you.
You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy, thereby. Thank you. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.